I think in the undergraduate class, most of them would have a Pi theorem.
Yeah, engineering class, depending on the which university, which class you get into, you get a different kind of Pi theorem. Okay, are you going to give me a wireless or this one?
If you'd rather have the wireless, I'll bring it down.
Yeah, if I have a wireless, it'll be easier for me to move.
The nationwide, oh. Florida State University is the most fun. If you can. This is the most culturally stimulating kind of feel bad. When you use the FUN, I kind of feel that.
Well, certainly our turbulent class must have fun, right? Because it's a fun university, we ought to have it. Okay, any questions for the tonight's exam? Yes.
Yeah. What do you mean of universal equilibrium theorem? Universal equilibrium theorem.
Universal equilibrium theory.
Universal.
Yeah, universal.
Kolmogorov.
Yeah, Kolmogorov scale and universal equilibrium.
Is it the? Oh.
Equilibrium.
Okay, Kolmogorov said that if you trace all the turbulent, the large AD, median AD, give it going to small. When you're looking at the very smallest AD, that is where you reach the universal equilibrium case. That essentially is what you generate, all the turbulent kinetic energy get transferred to that small eddy, and that is where all the energy gets dissipated out.
And Reynolds number equal to 1?
Yes, reaching the smallest eddy, okay? And if you plot, Kolmogorov did plot. For example, you can go to mixing layer, shear layer, boundary layer, jet, wake, and so forth. Now, if you're looking at large AD spectra, by looking at how, when we say spectra is the intensity of a particular wave or particular AD size that you got. So you see the large AD structure is depending on your mean flow a lot. For example, wake or jet. You know it right away is going to be different. You see the wake is kind of dying out, so forth. So if you're looking at the large AD spectra, it is going to show up a little bit different in terms of spectral distributions. That means intensity of a different wave size. But no matter what kind of flow you are looking at, when you're looking at the smaller and smaller AD, the spectra slope tend to be approaching a kind of a universal. Okay, no matter what the flow you're looking at, boundary layer, jet, and wake, you're looking at the small eddy side of it, the distribution seems to become universal. So that means everybody reaching about the same spectra. So that is to say, if you're looking at, say, wake, then maybe large eddy will be rotating at a certain speed and a certain side distribution. But if you go to a smaller eddy side of it, whether or not you're looking at wake or jet, they're all approaching to be the same behavior, the same distribution of the spectra, so the slope will become the same. That is where Kolmogorov said that when you reach that stage, the basic parameter is the kinematic viscosity and the epsilon. Okay, so that is what he is talking about.
And
yes?
Also one more question. Can you say something about isotropic process in mathematics?
Okay. When you... I think isotropic is, I think it's a Greek word, if I'm not wrong. The iso means independent of direction, okay? Tropic is essentially the coordinate of the direction. So when you said isotropic, it's independent of orientations,
mm-hmm.
Okay? So to give you an example of a non-isotropic behavior, non-isotropic material, let's say my kind of short note here. you can see this paper bundle here, it's behaved different in this direction, that direction, and this direction, that direction may be the same because all paper line up there. So you can see the heat conduction going this way and heat conduction going this way certainly is going to be different because you can see the heat conduction got to go through a layer of the paper, a layer of the air, a layer of the paper, a layer of the air, goes through this way. But the heat conduction going this way either straight goes through the air in gap or goes through the paper material all the way through. So you see the behavior of this material is non-isotropic because it's depending on the direction. So you call it anisotropic, all right? Now, if you're looking at the chunk of air I just grabbed there, you're looking at the, whichever the direction looking at, it behaves the same, okay? And so that we call it isotropic.
Yeah, I think physically, I think it's very clear, but how about mathematically?
Okay, mathematically, if you, for example, you have a tensor of the fourth order, like we derived the Navier-Stokes equation, remember? Now, there are lots of a parameter there in the very beginning. The tensor of fourth order, they have a certain relation you can mathematically derive. The tensor of fourth order must depend on the three parameter and so forth. if a tensor of second...
Can you just combine the page 13?
Page 30.
Modeling of production term for is from page 13 for
okay, page 30.
Equation.
Okay.
Yeah, here's at the bottom line, say if I do not equal to
I see, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. If you're looking at
this item.
Yeah. Let me see if I can write something. If you let's take a Reynolds stress, for example, okay. Let's say we take a correlation of looking from your side. This is a U, this is a V. All right. So U is fluctuating this way, V is fluctuating this way. So when you say that UI, which is a 1, UJ, which is a 2, so you have a U and V correlation that way. Now, if you say there is a correlation, that means this particular turbulent flow, when you are fluctuating this way, there is a preference of V being going a certain way. So, for example, the fluctuation tend to go this way. So you say that the U fluctuate this way, V fluctuate this way. When the U fluctuate backward, then the V got to go downward because you said it's preferred in this way. Now, when you say there's a preferred orientation of that one, then certainly it's an anisotropic, right? So if you say that it's an isotropic turbulent, that means U is fluctuating this way, V doesn't have to have a preference of either go this way or that way, so that means V is equally up and down. So that is to say what? The U and V should not correlate. If U and V correlate, that means I have a preference this way or that way. So that is say I and J, when they are not equal, that means on the shear, either the UV or VW or WU. If that exists, then you right away know this turbulent is anisotropic.
Yeah, how can we look at this?
Mm-hmm. Okay. So if you are looking at
this item,
are you looking at item
C?
C, okay. Yeah. Okay. Okay, you're looking at this term, okay? I and J is not equal. Okay, even though this is derivative, you might as well just think like a Reynolds shear stress, okay? If I not equal to J, let's say take I is 1, J equal 2, so you'll be partial U, you'll be looking at the U, this will be like a V, okay? So if you say that I not equal to J, this term is not equal to zero, then you are talking about anisotropic. If I is equal to J, then the isotropic, that means you see this side and that side, they are all square, right? If I equal J, then it will square out, so it will not be zero, right? If I not equal to J, if you say it exists, it's non-zero, then you know, just like as I say, Reynolds stress, they are correlated. You got that?
But so in this way, we can find even the UI UJ for the.
So you'll be looking at this term too. If I not equal to J, then you are saying the derivative in the x direction and derivative y direction multiplied together, they are correlated. So that means that they have a preference. Anytime you have a preference, then it's not isotropic. Isotropic must be independent of preference.
And
independent of orientation.
For the Reynolds stresses, U I U J. When I do not equal to J, then we can also say this is anisotropic.
That's right. If you're looking at the Reynolds stress, okay? Looking at the, let me see if I can pull one. Yeah. For example, you're looking at this term, which is happening in our Navier-Stokes equation, taking average, this one.
Okay.
Now, if I equals J, that means U square, V square, W square. They are all square, right? So certainly you know it cannot be zero unless no turbulent. As long as there is turbulent, then the U square, V square, W square is non-zero, all right? Let's start talking about I not equal to J, okay? I not equal to J, then you are talking about the UV, V, W, W, U, okay? Because that I not equal to J, you got to pick either 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 1, and so forth, right?
No, isotropic, this item.
Yeah, if it is a isotropic, that means independent of orientation, then you cannot have a flow with I not equal J correlated. Because once it's correlated, as I already showed physically, they have a preference of oscillation.
So
that is the first requirement. The second requirement is isotropic when the I equal to J. U fluctuation, V fluctuation, W fluctuation, they are non-zero, but the isotropic also requires independent of a preference. So I cannot have a U fluctuate bigger and the V fluctuate just a tiny. So they all three, U square must be equal, V square must be equal, W square. That is another equation because they got to be the same. Even though they are non-zero, but you got to be the same.
So in this way, in our equation, some item satisfy isotropic conditions, some item do not satisfy.
That's right. So here, if you view this term times this kinematic viscosity, isn't that like an epsilon? Well, epsilon ij. But when you make a I equal j, then it's a square, all right? Now, I not equal to j, then you right away say that, well, when you're looking at this times that one, it looks like an epsilon. And you know epsilon is associated with small eddy. Right? It's where the dissipation occurred. And when you said the smallest eddy under the postulation, you said it's isotropic dissipation. If you admit that, then you got to make this term isotropic behavior. So when you are doing modeling, that doesn't mean that you said isotropic dissipation. So every term in the equation where I not equals J, you throw them out. You cannot do that because you got to understand where the physical phenomenon is manifesting in your particular term. So in that argument, when the I not equal J, this side or that side got to be equal to J, zero. But the I equal to J, you know this is square out, this is square out, so it's not equal to zero. Okay? So it will not be zero, but if you're looking at the I and the J here, when the I equal to J, then you are partial U, partial X, partial V, partial Y, partial W, partial Z, and you factor this parenthesis out, you just find it's an incompressible divergence of U, which would be zero. So you can argue that within the parenthesis, I not equal J go to zero. When I equal J, you know the parenthesis is not equal zero, but the outside equals zero, so everything goes to zero. All right? Okay, so now, as I last time pointed out, if you say that my smallest eddy is not necessarily isotropic, now you see right away you are going to retain this when I not equal J. It's a lot of work. Because you see, when you assume the isotropic dissipation, you throw that term away so you don't have to worry about it. But once you say smallest eddy is non-isotropic, right away you get that term in there. So you got to do something about that.
So we can say that when some item, including ij and I not equal to j, we can say this item is non-isotropic.
Say that again. There are some item you want to make it I equal J.
Not equal J.
If you realize that particular term physically is associated with the smallest eddy. Smaller eddy. I wouldn't say smallest. Smaller eddy. If you're looking at the, some other term, you do not know. For example, this term. Okay? You're looking at that one, do you know that term is only important in the smallest eddy? You cannot say.
Yeah, for the molecular diffusion.
Mm-hmm.
Can you say this is isotropic? Molecular?
No, no.
So we have to keep this item?
In theory, you like to keep it, but then you're looking at this. This is molecular diffusion, this is turbulent diffusion. Okay, if you're looking at only pure mathematically, you don't know which one is bigger, right? But if you think physically what is happening, for example, I'm using a cup of coffee here. Molecular diffusion, that means that they don't know whether or not they're turbulent because you're using a molecular diffusion. So you pour the milk or the cream in. So you can see coffee is not going to mix. You can see a white streak in there, right? It's still rotating. You said, I got to get a better mixing. What do you do? You put the spoon in there doing that. So you are doing turbulent. So you know it. These things, if you have a turbulent in there, is going to be much bigger than that one. And of course, maybe right now in the class you haven't seen the lots of experiment, you don't have that feeling, but if you go to the laboratory and perform the experiment, right away you see the turbulent mixing probability is 100,000 times, sometimes 10,000 times quicker than your molecular diffusion. For example, if I open a perfume here, okay, you probably have to wait maybe 1 or 2 minutes before you can smell it. But if I go on like this, probably in about 10 seconds, you probably will smell the perfume coming to you. So that means I'm adding a turbulent diffusion to it. So turbulent diffusion typically very easily go over 100 times, 1,000 times over you. That's why you're looking at some of the paper I pass out, some people doesn't even bother the writing the molecular diffusion part of it.
Yeah, but in our modeling, even modeling the...
I leave it there, okay? I leave it there for mathematical reason or for completeness.
Yeah.
Because you never know, for example, you got to come to the wall. Okay, come to the wall when the turbulent keep die out, but the molecular diffusion is always there, even though it's small. So there will be a stage, like we talk about the inner law. When you keep coming there, what happened? Molecular diffusion and the turbulent diffusion eventually become the same. As a matter of fact, the turbulent will die out. When you come to the wall, molecular diffusion is still there.
Yeah, Now I'm talking even for the turbulent diffusion,
yes.
We model it with the some item like this patch UI user.
That's right. Error. We model it with a gradient.
Yeah, and this is also non-isotropic, right?
That's right. That is non-isotropic.
So yeah. What I'm saying in our modeling, some item
That's right. Now some item that you know it's only related with the smaller AD. The larger AD, that term may not be important. And that is tough when you first start the turbulence modeling. You just don't know. You're looking at the term, you don't know this term physically what it's doing. Is this doing associated with the large AD or smaller AD? And that's why I try to keep saying that you see epsilon, you got to think it's more associated with the smaller AD. So this is not necessarily associated with only smaller AD. You can have a large AD going on there, you still have a Reynolds stress. Reynolds stress is anisotropic, so it's a preference there. So the gradient in the X direction, Y direction there can be all different.
Yeah.
Right? So it's indeed difficult. At the very beginning when I was studying the turbulence model about 15 years ago, it's kind of tough, you just don't know it. But the more you go back and repeat it, looking at your model, then you realize that. Of course, we might mislead ourselves to believe it, which may not be true, right? Vinay, you want to say something?
Yeah, what happens to the fluctuating terms in uniform flow? I mean, you drop them out when you take...
Okay, fluctuating term in the uniform flow. Let's take this equation. Okay, you got a K equation here. Uniform flow, that means this is zero, right? Because no mean velocity gradient there. If it's a relatively uniform, you don't have a much gradient available here, right? So what do you get is a dk dt is minus epsilon, okay? Now epsilon is a fluctuation, instantaneous, and then you take an average of that one. So but then you know it, the fluctuation is going to die out because dk dt is going to be minus epsilon here. All right. So in the wind tunnel, remember we're looking at those wind tunnel grid turbulence. It go and die out. We'll see the experiment today when we're looking at the constant.
So basically, throw the diffusion term because of the physical reason.
Yes. Right. Essentially, you are going to say there will be a relatively uniform, not much gradient. Actually, the gradient is there. You know, the wind tunnel comes in, the turbine kinetic is a kind of gradual drop like this way. So it's approximate to you. You let it go to zero. And it's obviously, you see, you may not see the turbulence going on. Just imagine my hand here. Take it away. Looking at the air, if you can imagine what is going on there, you see, I got an eddy there, probably eddy die out, in about 30 seconds. It's become a big puff, okay? Okay, yes.
In the epsilon equation, you throw the production term, right?
Did you say 9?
9:30.
9:30 or
9?
9:30.
9:30, right? So we have another 30 minutes, yes.
So you throw the production term in the epsilon equation. So basically, you lose connection between your mean flow and the...
Which term?
The production term.
Production term in, right, in epsilon equation, all right?
What do you do to recover the connection between the mean flow and production?
Okay. You're looking at the epsilon equation here, right? Now, the production term, we call this term and that term because they have an interaction of second derivative here, interaction of first derivative there, okay? Today, the Lin talk about this one, so now we kind of quickly review that will be set equal to zero because isotropic dissipation, that's zero. Incompressible, that make I go zero. Now this term, historically, even though I don't believe it myself, but I got to tell you everybody's doing it, this term by compare with this term, they say this is smaller. So when you are looking at like Adao is doing $10, $20 go to football ticket, you got to buy $100 gold in the price, $200. Why you worry about 10 cents, 15 cents? So you say, oh, don't worry. So they just throw it out. Which I don't think it's always the case. Sometimes somewhere 15 cents can become $15 or $150. Right? So that we like to keep it. But if you keep it, then this term is unknown. So you got to do a modeling. All right? So it's the same thing here. If you say that small L is not isotropic, then you got to keep this. Then you say, okay, what I'm going to do with it? All right. Actually, many of you are questioning how this is done, and indeed so. I think I question it, and I question it very hard for about 10 years, and I tried to do something about it. Some of the model seems to improve a little bit, but there are so many people who want a simpler model, they just don't worry about that one. And as you already see it, the last time we do the modeling, they do it by recovering the production term, right, come right back from that one. So they kind of did the two wrong things, make it about right. so like that kind of feeling that I have. Even though you go and talk to Professor Rodi or Professor Lamdi, they probably feel a little bit different. Right? As a matter of fact, Dr. Cross-Parrott doesn't believe all this turbulence modeling at all because he's more experiment-oriented. But on the other hand, I talked to him, I said, okay, what would you do? And because Dr. Cross-Parrott mostly looking at boundary layer phenomenon and kind of high shear flow. But if you're looking at a large flow in the pump or large circulation, like ocean circulation, atmosphere circulation, or separation flow behind something there, the model he like to use, he's using a Lomac or mixing lens, kind of modify a little bit there. You see, you can modify to make it satisfactory to a particular type of the flow you're looking at. But if you take that model, say, okay, now let's do it generally for any flow, it'll fail again. So even though I know he is not particularly excited with all of this model, but on the other hand, he cannot come up with any better than that too. So, okay? All right. Let's see. Is that Ken or someone need a copy of which? I thought I'd bring, okay, maybe after the class I can give you. Okay, any other questions? If not, I'd like to kind of looking at the very last equations and then go to the turbulent constant. Okay, let me kind of quickly summarize what we have done. Yep. We take the Navier-Stokes equation, incompressible flow, as a matter of to be more precise, kind of a viscosity is a constant. Then you take the average of that one, forget about the buoyancy term here. So you have an average of a time rate change of a momentum is equal to pressure, equal to the molecular diffusion momentum, and then the Reynolds stress comes in here. Now for Reynolds stress, we model it. So you see the exact equation like this. We can make, maybe just looking at the right part here. Triple correlation, pressure velocity correlation, we use that gradient model to get to something like this, right? The molecular diffusion part of here, we keep it intact here, okay? The production term here, which is remain about the same over here. Now the dissipation term here, now you got to recognize this physically is more associated with the smaller eddy. Now the I and the J, if we assume it's an isotropic small eddy dissipation, then the I and J not equal to zero. That's why we use it here. You can see using Kronecker delta and the epsilon is only the normal direction of it. Okay? So we use this. If you say that, well, I don't like small eddies isotropic, then you got to do a different modeling here. Now, pressure strain term here, which you already derived containing only one term is a small eddy fluctuation, one large with a mean flow fluctuation, mean flow and the fluctuation correlation. And we call it a redistribution, one slow, one rapid. And we give it two terms here, one in the slow redistributions is this, one rapid redistribution is the C2 term here, okay? So we got a three constant here, and the K equation, of course, will follow by just taking a trace of that. Now, if you go to the epsilon equations, let's have a quick review here. Again, the turbulent diffusion part here, we model it by the gradient. And the proportionality, we're using isotropic proportionality because K is a scalar, epsilon is a scalar. All right? If you don't like it, remember we talk about taking some people taking one of the K out here, making, since a K is a U square, so they make it the only place you can get a non-isotropic or the direction dependent is a UI UJ. So make it, instead of a K, they make it one of it is a UI UJ, okay? Something like that. Now, the argument of the production term, this term and that term, historically are being all thrown out, which I don't like. And then they call this the total source term for the time rate change of this one, and they making this as a model proportional to partly production, partly destruction, okay? And this is where you gain this production of a mean velocity gradient back here. And I keep insisting that should come from, this should come from here by doing something here, but they did it the kind of wrong reason, but by bringing it back from the wrong reason by saying this two actually come from this two, depending on. So I think a little bit of wave hand in there. But anyway, we got a two constant here. Okay. Now the heat flux part, I'm not going to talk about it. So what do we have for these two equations, K and epsilon equation? You already got Ck, which is the diffusion part of it. C1, C2 is a pressure strain term there, redistribution. One slow return to isotropic. One is a rapid return to isotropic. And then the epsilon equation, again, just come from diffusion with a subscript epsilon 1, epsilon 2, that is come from the production and destruction term there, all right? Okay, so now with the remaining time, let's see, this six constant that I put it now here, most of them turn out to be like a constant, okay, in that neighborhood, but you will find later on many people modify this constant by timing or timing another modified function in there. So either you want to think this is the constant, or I prefer as a coefficient because it can change later on. Okay, so let's look at how the constant is determined. Did I pass out the seat? Let's see, did I bring it here? No. Okay, if I'm not, I will give it to you next time. This is just a summary of a kind of quick view of what constant let me kind of define. Okay, the determination of constant is not necessary in order of CK, C1, C2, C epsilon, and so forth, C epsilon. So I'm going to cite a couple experiments, the C epsilon 2, C1, C epsilon 1, C2, and so forth. I probably won't have time to do every one of them. You can see a couple of the experiments that we are doing. One is a wind tunnel, but this is kind of a little bit different kind of a wind tunnel. There is a contraction part of it here. I will explain in a moment. This is a circular wind tunnel, has an even larger contraction there. This is a wind tunnel. You put in lots of a plate here to make the bottom part of the flow slower because you got to go through a little bit larger distance of resistance. So as a result, you can shape your wind tunnel flow after this kind of a plate grid here. You have a linear portion part in there, okay? And you can look at the boundary layer. You can look at a grid which oscillate back and forth. So there will be no mean flow, but there will be a fluctuation. So we use this kind of a flow to determine constant, okay? So that is kind of just quick review. As a matter of fact, everything is in your note anyway. Now, before I look at the constant, let me say this. As the last time I commented on, if you go to the viscous model, you can go to viscometer and measure the centistoke or stoke or the torque there. You cannot just stretch or just increasing the velocity of your viscometer and hope you can measure the turbulent coefficient or the constant. So we got to do a different kind of flow. And let's look at the first one now. I call it the determination of a C epsilon 2, okay? C epsilon 2, this is the epsilon equations, and the last term, the destruction term part there. Okay, if you're looking at the equation, you probably can looking at it here. Epsilon equations, I write it down for sort of like a two-dimensional. I have write the X and the Y here. C epsilon 2 happened to be on the last term here. Okay, so I just kind of write that equation out to let you see it here. Actually, this is still in the Cartesian tensor notation, very general. Only this part, we have only X and Y in there. Okay, now, what we are doing here, let me kind of, okay, you're looking at a wind tunnel here. From your end is from this side, flowing that side. The wind tunnel comes in, I put the grid here, okay? Now, if you just take a measurement of the flow behind the grid without the contraction there, what is going to happen is that, let me see if I can even more amplify that. You can see if you measure right behind here, you are going to see the U square is not equal to V square. And so forth. As a matter of fact, U square is about 25% larger than the V square. So that means wind tunnel flow comes in here, you find this side oscillates more than this side and that side. Because you have a flow coming in this way, it excites this side a little bit more. So as an isotropic idea, if this is bigger than this side, then you see that the flow has a directional orientation. So it's not really isotropic. So what you can do is take this flow and contract it with the area ratio of about 1.27. Okay? But what you can do you get the idea from your intermediate fluid or any viscous fluid that if you accelerate the flow tend to laminarize or flow tend to become a little bit smooth. If you decelerate the flow, it tends to increase in the fluctuations. I kind of, it's not a good example, but to give you a feeling, when you accelerate a car, can you have a Corvette or something can accelerate very quick, you feel very smooth when accelerating. Kind of smooth. But when you are in the emergency, you step on the brake, what happened? The car is going to have a little bit harder control. So you see, deceleration tend to create more, the acceleration tend to smooth out there. So you can see it here, if you contracted the flow accelerate in this direction, then it will kill this side of fluctuation. So finally end up U square, V square, W square will be about equal. So you keep trying by contracting it. So you can kill the U fluctuation there. So now, once you reach this section there, they say, aha, I am almost getting isotropic behavior because U square, V square, W square, they are all about equal. Okay, so if that is the case, then you say, okay, let me take the measurement of that, which is K of course is the U square, V square, W square add together divided by 2, and starting from somewhere here, and you take an account there, so the K is going to decay like that, which is x to the minus 1.08 is most of the data it will decay, because you see uniform flow, you know the turbulent cannot exist, so it got die out, right? So you have a flow comes in, contract a little bit, take a measurement here, and it's a decay, okay? Now, philosophically, I don't like this decimal point, 1.08. I think should be minus 1, is my feeling. Why? Just a sheer intuition that the simple flow should be a simple relation, not 1.08. I have seen some people even give a minus 1.2, even minus 2.2, depending on the your experiments good or bad there. So I think the best they can do is up to about 0.8. Okay, 1.08 here. If it is a minus 1, I love it because it will give my mathematical relation much simpler. But anyway, that is a decay, right? Okay, so now let's looking at what this flow is doing. Even though the flow get accelerated, once it comes to the straight section here, you should expect the flow in the center section is fairly uniform. Other than very close to the wall, of course, you have reduction to the non-slip flow there. So looking at the center portion there, then flow will be uniform, that only U, so V and the W will be zero, U will be constant, all right? So if that is the case, let's looking at the K equation here. You're looking at the K equation here, there is, this is the average equation, so there will be no time dependent because the wind tunnel is a steady flow. I have a U here, K is decaying a little bit. You can see the slope there. There will be no change with respect to Y or G direction. I slow them out. And the flow is relatively uniform. Although you can argue, say, G, if you say K is decaying with respect to X, remember this is changing here. Why don't you keep, why can you throw this one out? Okay? Why can you throw this one out? Now, past the better argument is this, if I can get my original K equation. Let me see if I can get. Yes. Looking at this is the K equation. If I put the original K equation here, the exact K equation here. You see this is a fluctuation and a K fluctuation. So here, you're looking at this. This is a triple correlation. The triple correlation, if it ever exists, then it's anisotropic, right? Now, I just created the wind tunnel as the isotropic flow. So the isotropic flow, this should go to zero, okay? But you see, once you make a modeling, you come down here, then you pull out a gradient there. So even though you do have a little bit of a gradient here, fairly good argument say that this path is very small, okay? So you throw them out. The flow is a uniform flow, so that is not existent. So you have this, okay? So that means that after the approximation, you only get this U convective term plus this one epsilon here. You do the same thing for epsilon equation. It's a steady flow, not there. U is there. There is a little bit of a gradient because you already know there is a existing here. this row out, again, it's a relative uniform flow, no productions, and only this term left. So as a result of this two equations for this particular flow, you end up K equation is this, epsilon equation is this. So now you see why we pick this flow. Uniform flow is the simplest. You can eliminate so many things. You can eliminate some of the gradient. You keep the basic ingredient of the convective velocity here. So this actually help us in doing experiment because you see, as I keep saying, experiment to measure the epsilon is tough, all right? But if you'll be able to measure in the K, which is relatively easy, you just have a probe. You know, even just one probe here, wind tunnel comes in here, I put my probe this way, I measure U square, all right? After I make a measure, I put my probe in this way, I make V square, W square, okay? So I can, in three experiment, I can get a K and measure with a distance down. So I will have this and that, taking a derivative, give me the epsilon. Okay, so the epsilon data will be available. So I take that epsilon data, take one more derivative, which may be a little bit risky because the data taking a derivative. But anyway, if you do it carefully, you'll be able to get this, K is there, epsilon square. So the, what you can do is this. By knowing K is minus to this exponent, I really love to have just x to the minus one power. Would be very simple, right? So if I take this one, then you can see epsilon is minus two power. But anyway, with that exponent, it will give me C epsilon two will be n, which is x to the that this power. Yeah, okay? So if I do that, I get a 1.92. If I have just minus one here, you can see I'll get two. So that means that that constant should be 1.92. If it is the exponent of decay is minus 1, I get 2. Okay, so there is a couple percent difference there. But you see that if you call it a constant or other coefficients, it's there. Okay? All right. I don't know if I can get on the second constant or not. Probably not. Okay? But anyway, you see we perform experiment after experiment, devise it in such a way so you can single out one constant. So right now we achieve it the first one, C epsilon 2, then we, if it is an isotropic, let me just mention here, if you squeeze more, if you say that just right behind the wind tunnel screen here, it is not isotropic because you fluctuate more. So if you contract it here, this will reduce a little bit more, so make the U square, V square, W square the same. Then you said, why don't we squeeze more? Squeeze it smaller here. What happened? This becomes smaller and this will remain there. So you create a strong anisotropic behavior of a flow. So if you do that, then you'll be able to retain some of the terms such as like this that you are going to see later on, maybe after the exam we were looking at that. So that making some of the pressure strain term does not go to zero because you remember pressure strain term, if it's isotropic, everything just cancel out. So we want an isotropic behavior and yet it's a uniform flow. Why is a uniform flow so attractive to us? Because all the mean derivative you got to deal with, so if you have a no gradient there, you can throw all those terms out and only retain the sum of the one. So you can see the experiment we are doing start with a uniform flow, if not, it's a straight line linear flow. Yeah.
I'm just wondering, this constant, C epsilon 2, is derived for an internal flow. Has there ever been any experiment to see if it's the same for external flows? Is it
possible? Well, first of all, when you say internal flow, I don't think it's exactly internal flow. You say the wind tunnel is the internal flow. But let's say we take a screen out in the outdoor and just put it there, let the wind blow through. Behind that one is not necessarily we call internal flow. It's really not the internal or external, it's just a uniform flow. right? So if you're looking at the, like a pipe, then you can say internal flow because all the velocity gradient generated has a boundary confined it. But if you're just looking at the uniform flow, it's really not necessary to say it's an internal flow. So nobody really worry about this only for internal flow or external flow. Actually, there are people questioning it. Okay, you generate this constant with the isotropic turbulence. Now, is this the constant still true when you have a non-isotropic turbulence? That's some people question that. But the argument is this: if your model is truly a model, when we say the model, that means apply to this flow, that flow, that flow, or applicable, then you call model. If it's only be good for this one, then it's no longer a model because what is a model? All right. So for that sense, if a model is correct, if I determine this constant through the isotropic flow, I should be able to use this same coefficient for the other type of flow, which some people would doubt it. And you begin to find, indeed, they are not that universal in the model. So you have a kind of modification here and there. Okay, I think we better get out of the class. They have something, 9:30 is coming. Is this about a good time to stop? Okay, thank you.